Hello, thank you so much for tuning in. It is such a great pleasure to introduce our special guest. My name is Danny Nguyen, and the topic today of our talk show is about condemnation, eminent domain. Owning a piece of property, a piece of land, has several advantages and privileges, but it also has responsibilities. And today, I'd like to talked about a situation when you receive a notice from the government wanting to take your land. What do you have to do? Please help me to welcome Mr. David Showalter. Mr. David Showalter is a 1977 graduate of Baylor Law School. He holds a degree in Juris Doctor, JD. Mr. Showalter also manages an 8-attorney law firm with offices in the greater Houston area in the Richmond, Rosenberg, in Texas.
Yes.
Welcome to the show. Thank you for being here.
Thank you, Mr. Nguyen. I appreciate being invited. I'm honored to be here today to talk about this topic. And it's a very important topic to landowners across our area because there are so many eminent domain projects that are underway.
Right, right. The reason I invited you, in addition to having known you for several years, but I also have the experience of working with you on some of the cases about eminent domain, and I was very impressed with your professionalism. So I hope that with your several years of experience, you can share with our audience about eminent domain. Before we start, let me define what condemnation is. What eminent domain is?
It's a good question. It's a term that strikes fear in the heart of a lot of property owners, but it's basically right. The power of the government to come in and take private property away from citizens.
The government have that right?
They do have that right.
For what reason? On what cause?
They typically have to show that there's a public purpose and a public necessity for the taking of the property.
What percentage of landowners facing that situation?
You typically see it can be in a lot of situations, but landowners along freeways or roadways for road widening projects. Maybe it's a pipeline cutting through your acreage. Maybe it's a power line. Maybe it's a detention pond.
Right, right. How long in advance usually a landowner can be aware of the situations of condemnation?
That's true. A lot of times the road projects are announced usually fairly far in advance, and there's a lot of public information
right, right.
about it. And then the public entity sets about to try to talk people into doing deals instead of going through the condemnation process.
Right. But they must have a very reasonable cause, which is to use the property for public interest. They cannot just take a private property to use for not a private reason.
That's generally true. Sometimes you'll see a pipeline company that claims they're going to transport the public's oil and gas when really it's for their own personal product. So you want to make sure in some of those instances that it really is a public purpose. But roadway projects or the Texas Central Railway project,
right.
What they've got to prove, it's for a public purpose and they're not taking any more than they really need for the project, and show a public necessity for the project.
What if a landowner disagree with that?
You know, what we find, you know, people don't want to engage in the process at all.
Right.
This is my property, I don't want to sell it.
Right.
I don't want to sell it for a road. Typically, we cannot stop a project, but we make sure that our clients, the landowners, get full compensation for the land that they're losing. And it's a very kind of nuanced or complicated analysis. It's not just like selling a strip of land. There's a lot more that goes into calculating your damages.
So basically, when you receive that notice, you don't have any legal right to force the government not to take your land, but you have an option to maximize the value of your land. Would you talk about that?
I will, and that's where we think we bring the greatest value. Just like an experienced commercial broker, an experienced attorney in these areas, and bring a lot of value to the landowners. There are lots of attorneys who do lots of different things, but the eminent domain area is a specialized area of the law. And so we help our clients understand what they're entitled to recover. We help explain the process, and we walk with our clients through the whole process. We really take the fear out of it and level the playing field for the landowner against the government or pipeline company.
Right. Just like any other industry, specialization is the key. That is where you have your knowledge depth. And I know that you have, I mean, haven't been in business for 40 years, more than four decades. How many cases have you done?
Danny, I've lost count of the cases. We've handled thousands of cases. We've helped thousands of people in lots of different situations, you know, be it litigation, real estate, that. And so that experience that we have in dealing with eminent domain cases, and we've handled nearly 500 eminent domain cases.
Wow.
We know the angles, and we know the business, and we know how to help our people.
Right. What would be a chance of success for all the cases that you have done?
We have experienced success, I would say, in almost 100% of our cases. And I define success as getting for our clients more money than what the state or the pipeline company or power line company wanted to pay them at the outset. So we virtually in every case help our clients get more money.
Yes, I've seen the same thing, because as a landowner, I receive a notice from the government buying my land for a certain amount, and you come in and try to fight for us to get more money.
Exactly.
So any amount that is greater than amount initially offered is a success. So the question is, how much more money
are we able to get for our
client? To get for your client is the key. So what is the process of the whole the whole thing?
I'll give you an overview of the process, and it has some complexities along the way, but basically the condemning authority will make an offer.
Yes.
We will sometimes try to negotiate with them, but usually it's unsuccessful because they are not going to get to a high enough level to satisfy us or the clients.
Right.
So then it goes to condemnation, which is not a scary process, although it's a scary word to landowners.
Right.
Where the judge will appoint three lay people in the county to hear your case. So we'll go to a special commissioner's hearing,
right,
where the special commissioners will hear from the state or the pipeline company about how much they want to pay. And then we come in with our evidence with appraisers, brokers. The landowner can testify about their opinions of property value. And those three commissioners will make a decision on the spot how much should be awarded to the landowner. Then the state or condemning authority has to pay that amount of money, and usually that's more than what they wanted to pay initially. Then we withdraw that money from the registry of the court for the landowner, and then we continue to negotiate and fight for more money. So don't be afraid of the process, but get somebody that knows how to handle the process to protect you. Each step along the way, we're getting more money for our clients. And then usually we'll go to a mediation, where we sit down with a trained mediator. The parties will negotiate even further and come up to a solution that pays even more money, and then we're done with the case.
Wow, wow. So your advice is not to settle with the first meeting. Even the offered price from the government is higher than the initial.
Right. Many people think, and you may be a savvy negotiator or you know a lot about real estate, but unless you have like an attorney that really understands it, working with a broker and appraiser, you will never get as much as you could with the team. So you can do it yourself, but you're not gonna make the kind of progress you could with an experienced lawyer and appraiser and broker.
Right. Earlier you mentioned the word, don't be scared. And it's really strike my chord, because we are very fortunate, we're very blessed to live in a country that the government right, and the people, the taxpayers, had a tax right.
Right.
So basically, I mean, as a citizen, you, as a taxpayer, you have every legal right to fight to maximize the value and then you are helping them with that process. So I guess the advice from you is don't be intimidated by the word government and all of the agents trying to intimidate you to sell yourself short from the beginning. Am I right?
Exactly, Danny. A lot of people, I mean, that's one of the benefits of being a citizen or resident of the United States of America. There are lots of things wrong with our country, but you have rights guaranteed by our Constitution, and one of the most fundamental rights are your property rights. Your property cannot be taken away from you without just compensation.
Right.
And there's a whole process of due process, this procedure that we know and understand. The government can't just come in and take your property without compensation, and certainly not at a low price.
I got you.
Some people think, well, I can't fight City Hall,
right.
I can't stop the state, I can't stop these powerful corporations. That's not true. We help level the playing field.
Right. Well, that's where you come in.
Yes.
That's why you will be doing the work. You represent your client to fight all the way to the end. And I also understand that the compensation structure is based on performance.
Exactly.
So that I think so. That is a great structure because it will put the pressures on an attorney so that he or she will work hard and do the best that he can, you know, to get the maximum value for the client.
That's true. Just a brief word on that is
right.
Our clients are always guaranteed they're going to get the amount that the state or pipeline company wanted to pay
right.
at the outset. We only get paid if we get more money for the client. So
pretty
it's
similar
a no-lose situation.
Right, so pretty similar to the tax protest.
True.
We're going to talk about tax protest later.
Okay.
I know that. Let's talk a little bit about the first the hearing. Okay, so what does a landowner need to do to best prepare for that first hearing on his part?
The landowner, and we spend time with them in advance of the hearing,
right.
making sure they're comfortable with the questions that are going to be asked
right,
and
right,
the topics
right,
that
right,
are going to be
right.
covered. But the landowner, and we work with them, and we need the landowner's help to explain the characteristics of their property, you know, location, do they have information about other comparable sales in the area, do they have development plans, how are they currently using their property? How will losing some of the property impact the value of the rest of the property?
Right.
Those are the types of issues we want to explain to these three special commissioners so they can make a decision that's has all the information, not just what they're hearing from the state about what the state thinks the property is worth. And again, the special commissioner's hearing is an important step of the process,
right,
but
right.
it's not the end of the process. And so it's the special commissioner hearing, it's kind of informal, but it is
right.
like a little trial
right.
where both sides get to put on testimony and
right.
exhibits and documents. So it's an important step of the process. But what I like about it is the landowner, we're able to get for the landowner early on in the process all the money they were going to get anyway, while we fight for more money.
Right, right, right. Different parties had different value. Landowners had different value. The government has different value, and an appraiser has different values. I mean, it depends on perceptions and from the angle of which party is looking at it. So, what should be done to maximize the value of the land? So that the landowner will be maximize his value.
Those are good questions. And yes, you know, what can we do to maximize the landowner's position? Number one, I would counsel to not protest your taxes during the eminent domain process.
Right, right.
Because as we know, tax value is not evidence of fair market value.
Right.
But if a landowner goes in and says,
yes,
my property
yes.
is worth less, they'll use that against you. If you have development plans, go ahead and be pushing full steam ahead to develop your property because
right.
that shows you have commercial value and it really is going to impact
right.
your, even if it's unimproved land. So those are a couple of things, but educate yourself on your local market. Keep your property in good repair
right?
because that always helps. A lot of times they'll come in and try to depreciate your improvements
right.
because, well, it's not, it needs paint or it's older. but most people's buildings are serviceable or new and well maintained, and so we fight the depreciation battle also.
Right. It's just like a trial setting. I mean, on your part, you're trying to maximize the value.
Exactly.
And then the other part, they're trying to minimize the value.
And Danny, you know, in dealing with real estate, the appraisal professionals, it's an art. It's not a black and white science.
Right, exactly.
It's like practicing
exactly.
medicine sometimes.
Exactly.
But the appraisers...
That's why they call practicing law.
Practicing medicine. Yeah, so true. But the appraisers are hired by the state or the pipeline companies. They do thousands and thousands of appraisals. And, you know, yes, they have a license, and yes, they say this appraisal is my opinion of fair market value, but, you know, we know who they're working for, and that our job is to go find higher comparable sales, get appraisers and brokers that'll help us support the landowner's opinion on what their real value is.
Right. We don't have a lot of time in this show to go much into the appraising process, but what you said was so true. Because value in itself is based on perception as well. I mean, there's so many things that could not be defined on an ordinary appraisal method, if you will.
Right.
The three methods of giving value for a piece of properties are sales comparison,
yes,
correct?
Right.
Income producing.
Right, the income approach.
And
the replacement.
And the replacement. Which method is most popular?
That's a real good topic. The condemning authorities appraisers will pick one of those methods that results in the lowest value. We see it over and over again. Sometimes they will just ignore the income approach. When, you know, some of our clients, maybe they have a restaurant or it's a Starbucks site where you could, at a certain cap rate, generate a much higher value, and they'll just ignore that one.
Right.
So they're really supposed to consider all three valuation approaches, pick the one that's most appropriate. Also supposed to consider the highest and best use.
Right.
That's not necessarily what is this property being used for right now, but what could it be used for in the reasonably foreseeable future.
Right.
That's
the
highest and best use.
You know, maybe one of these days you and I invite an experienced appraiser so we can talk more in depth about a topic.
That would be a good
hopefully
discussion.
Hopefully that would be
a very helpful discussion.
Be a subsequent show.
Right.
But it seemed to me, I mean, I've been in commercial estate for 21 years, so sometimes determine a value for a piece of property could be a combination of several factors. But in addition to those three commonly used methods, how about opportunity cost?
True.
Because of you, government, you take my piece of land. Now I can no longer develop the project that I had always dreamed of. What do you say about that?
That would like tie into the income approach.
Right.
It's very true. There are some things that aren't compensable under eminent domain law, even though it really does result in harm to the landowner.
Right.
But you've got to pick these valuation methods carefully and construct a scenario where you can show the maximum amount of harm to your property owner. And just a little example, let's say you have a strip shopping center that's losing a little bit of parking. You know how important parking ratios are.
Yes, yes.
And having adequate parking for your customers. If you lose enough parking,
you lose a chance of getting tenant.
Exactly. And even though that shopping center is not being touched, in many cases, we can make the government pay for the whole center, even if it's not being touched, because they are damaging the value of your income-producing asset.
That's when an experienced attorney come in and examine carefully from every angle.
Exactly.
That's when I think this is the missing part of an inexperienced landowner compared to an expert. Okay, you have anything else to say about that? Before we go into
and we could talk a lot more, but yes, our advice is don't go it alone. Don't try to go it alone, because it is a very complicated area, but we are happy to work with landowners to maximize what their compensation is going to get from the government.
Right.
We understand the different angles that have to be considered.
You know, I believe in the specialization and expertise. You know, when I want to have my hair cut, I want to have somebody experience, exactly. Cut my hair. I'm not going to cut my hair to save some money. So the fact that, you know, trying to do it yourself, you know, could be could lead to a loss of chance of getting in a higher compensation. And another important point that I want to talk to you about this process is timing. Let's talk about the timing. Since the day a landowner has received a notice from the government, so what is the timeline process? How much time does he have to respond now? That show me some key key milestones.
Well, once the process starts, and you know, because of funding and schedules, you know, a project might get announced, but the start date, we don't really always know when that is.
Right.
But once you get a notice of a hearing, and sometimes things can start to go fast. That's why we should be involved early on, because once you get a notice of a hearing, you're only allowed 11 days, 10 days notice of the special commissioner's hearing. So that's
10
a
days?
Short time frame if they're really trying to push the project and take property fast. You only have about 10 days notice to get ready for the special commissioner's hearing. That hearing usually takes 2 to 4 hours.
Right. But
then we get a decision, then the money's deposited from the hearing and we withdraw that money for the landowner.
And yeah, yes, I understand that process, but
okay.
but 10-11 days is such a very short period of time to do anything. So, I mean, so is that can a landowner ask to extend it the time period so that he or she had a time to contact an attorney to prepare, to mentally prepare for the case?
Usually not, because by that time the state or the county, the city has made some effort to try to negotiate an amicable or a deal with the landowner.
Right, right.
So they have some notice, and then usually the city, they just throw up their hands and say, well, we're just going to take your property. So that's why early on we like to get involved. We try to negotiate some up front, but you really get more leverage at the special commissioner's hearing and after that to get
right.
more money for the client. But it can be a very short time frame.
Right.
Some people like to, I'm going to do it on my own, and then after special commissioner's hearing, I might call an expert, or right before that. But that's not the best practice.
Right.
And a lot of times, people that are trying to do it on their own, they'll say things that later on get used against them. They're providing information that they think will convince the condemning authority
right.
to pay more money, when in fact it's just going to be used against you. So,
right. Among all the clients that you have helped, what percentage of those people actually got a desirable result? We have talked about the probability of success, but you know, sometimes that expectation could be very varied. So I mean, so what percentage of that? I mean, of your client are happy with the true result?
I think most people are. From the outset, we try to help people have reasonable expectations. But I like to surprise our clients
right,
with good
right.
news, because often we get, this is in every case, 2, 3, 4, 5 times more money than what they were going to be offered or settled for in the
right,
first place.
Right.
So I think most folks are very happy, especially since it doesn't really cost them anything to hire us.
Yeah. Is there any case, even one case that you have experienced in your 40 years in this area that the government just took the land without paying anything?
No.
Is that possible?
No, it's not. And if it is, there's something wrong with the process. So,
is that a constitutional right?
You do have a constitutional right to not have your property taken away from you without just compensation.
Right.
Although
right,
a lot of people right. fear the power of the government, and for good reason.
Right. But talking about the government, we got a few minutes left. I didn't want to bring politics into it, but as you know, every president have different policy that affect commercial real estate. With the current president, Donald Trump, is there any prediction that that will impact commercial real estate, especially in this area, significantly?
That's an interesting question and very complicated.
And another topic.
It could be another topic. It's just kind of hard to predict which direction we're going to go. You know, I can't say property rights are the most fundamental right that we have. That and, you know, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. But property rights, you know, over the years we've seen a lot of legislation that's made it harder for injured people to get recoveries, limit recoveries, injured workers. The workers' compensation program is much harder for injured workers to actually get compensation. It just all favors business and government.
Right.
But property rights, you know, those are fundamental. And so my hope is that governments, they have to pay just compensation or have a constitutional amendment, and that would result in anarchy, I think.
Yes,
so.
Yes. You used the word fundamental. I mean, I absolutely in sync with you on that. I mean, that is your most core and most sacred right, is the right to own your own properties.
Yes.
And the right not to be taken from anybody.
Exactly.
Especially in Texas.
Exactly.
So I don't anticipate that, I mean, any president that would violate that core values and constitutional right of American, isn't it?
I think you're right. I think one thing to look out for is there might be efforts to limit people's access to good lawyers.
Right.
I think we should be vigilant to look out for those types of efforts.
Right. Thank you so much for watching The Anning Nguyen Show. For the past 20-something minutes, you have listened to our conversations with our special guest, Mr. David Showalter, a highly specialized attorney that helped his client to fight the government to get more compensation when his or her land been taken for public use. And before we wrap up, is there anything that you would like to say to the audience? I know there's a lot more to cover. So basically, we just covered the first phase of the first portion. And hopefully, with the second show, we will talk about what happened afterward, after the first hearing, and then afterward. But before that, I mean, would you like to say something before we ended the show?
Well, I would say, Danny, I'm honored to be invited to visit with you about this important topic, and I would love to come back and talk about it in more depth with you and the viewers of the TV station. But we would be honored and happy to help any of the folks that you know that are listening and watching that have these kind of issues with the land use rights and loss of property because of eminent domain projects. You know, we're in a fast, growing, vital economic area. It's a great town to be in. And, you know, there's give and take, but if they're knocking on your door and wanting to take your property, we understand that, but we want to make sure that our clients get adequately compensated.
Right.
Thanks for having me, Dan.
Right. Certainly. Thank you so much for being on our show. And I know that with your experience, by the way, tell me a little bit about yourself. I mean, were you born here? Were you born in Texas?
I'm one of those that got here as soon as I could. My wife was born and raised in Houston, Texas.
All right.
I was raised in Kansas City, Missouri, then went to a small church school in Oklahoma City, Bethany Nazarene College, now Southern Nazarene University, then Baylor Law School in Waco.
Right.
And then I came to Houston when I graduated from law school, and I've been practicing here in the Houston area since 1977.
1977.
Yes, 40 years, Danny.
Oh, wow, 4 decades. So with 4 decades, I know in addition to being an attorney, a business owner, an author, you are also property owners. You develop a lot of properties and you are knowledgeable about the business development and project development and EB-5 and all that. I feel like you have so much to offer to our audience who is a business owner, who is property owners. So hopefully there will be another opportunity for you to come back.
Great.
So we can talk about these topics so it will be beneficial to our audience. Again, I'm Danny Nguyen. Thank you so much for watching our show, and I look forward to our next show. Have a great day.